Today we will discuss bronchiectasis and lung abscess in respirology. So let's start with case number one. You see a 55-year-old female for the first time. She has a 2-year history of chronic daily cough, thick malodorous sputum and occasional hemoptysis. She has been treated with antibiotics for recurrent respiratory infections but is frustrated with her continued symptoms. She has never smoked. Her FEV1 to FEVC ratio is 60% and a CT scan show bronchial wall thickening and a luminal dilatation. The most likely diagnosis is, so what this condition is actually with chronic daily cough with thick malodorous sputum, occasional hemoptysis, bronchial on the CT scan, bronchial wall thickening and luminal dilation. This is most likely bronchiectasis, because what is actually bronchiectasis? It is irreversible dilatation of airways due to inflammatory destruction of airway walls resulting from persistently infected mucus. And it usually affects the medium-sized airways, and the most common sputum pathogens in the non-cystic fibrosis patients are H. influenzae, Pseudomonas aeruginosa and Moraxella catarrhalis. So actually, what are the signs and symptoms in bronchiectasis? The patient will have a chronic cough, purulent sputum, but in some patients, 10-20% patients, they may have dry cough. Patient will have dyspnea, fatigue, chronic rhinosinusitis, hemoptysis, and the hemoptysis can be massive. Recurrent pneumonia, local crackles. The local crackles may be inspiratory and expiratory, and there may be bronchi and wheezes. So sometimes there are difficulty to differentiate from chronic bronchitis from bronchiectasis. So what we will do? We'll do investigations, and pulmonary function tests often demonstrate the obstructive pattern, but it may be normal. So in chest x-ray, sometimes there are non-specific increased markings, linear atelectasis, loss of volume in affected areas. But there are specific tram tracking parallel, narrow lines radiating from hilum, or there may be honeycomb-like structures. So if we talk about symptoms, so the symptoms mostly are the chronic cough, thick malodorous sputum, occasional hemoptysis, bronchial wall thickening in the CT scan and luminal dilatation. The most specific and most sensitive test is high resolution thoracic CT, that is diagnostic and gold standard, and in that we see signet rings, dilated bronchi with thickened wall where diameter of the bronchus is greater than 1.5 times the diameter of accompanying artery. So let's see next question, which a 30-year-old man has a history of recurrent pneumonias, chronic cough dating from early childhood. The cough, which is worse in the morning and on lying down, is productive of foul smelling purulent sputum, which is occasionally blood tinged. The patient is chronically ill, has clubbed fingers, rails are heard over the posterior lung bases. So, which one of the following is the most likely diagnosis? So, it is bronchiectasis. It is bronchiectasis because bronchiectasis, we have already discussed, it is dilatation and destruction of larger bronchi caused by chronic infections and inflammations. And common causes are cystic fibrosis, immune defects, infection, though some cases appear to be idiopathic. Sometimes symptoms are chronic cough, purulent sputum, expectoration. Some patients may also have fever and dyspnea. So diagnosis is based on history and imaging, usually involving the high resolution CT. So treatment and prevention of acute exacerbations are with antibiotics, drainage of secretions, and management of complications such as super infections and hemoptysis. So treatment of underlying causes is important whenever possible. So in the clinical features, we have already seen that the patient will have chronic cough, dyspnea, fatigue, hemoptysis, recurrent pneumonias, and local crackles, ronchi, or wheezes. So we move to the next question. A 60-year-old male presents to the office complaining of a productive cough for 3 months. So he has productive cough for 3 months. He mentions that the sputum is plentiful and foul smelling. He is a chain smoker. Vitals are normal, within normal limits, except for a mild fever of 37.6 degree. Physical exam show finger clubbing. So bronchiectasis is one of the diseases which will have clubbing. Auscultations of the lungs show coarse crepitation in both lungs. Chest X-ray reveals increased vascular markings and peribronchial thickening. So we have already discussed what happens in bronchiectasis, that what we see in the CT scan is thickened bronchial walls where diameter of the bronchus is 1.5 times the diameter of the accompanying artery. So what is the diagnostic test of choice? So we have already discussed the gold standard is high resolution thoracic CT, that is diagnostic and gold standard, in which there will be signet rings and it is 87 to 97% sensitive and 93 to 100% specific. So the other tests that we can do are sputum culture, CBC, LFTs, immunoglobulin panel, serum IgG levels, sweat chloride if cystic fibrosis is suspected. But the gold standard is high resolution CT of the lungs. Case number 4, a 48-year-old male presents with a 6-month history of shortness of breath and chronic productive cough. Physical examination reveals coarse crackles in both the lungs bases and clubbing of the fingers bilaterally. Which of the following is the most likely diagnosis? So it is again bronchiectasis. So case number 5, a 52-year-old male presents with productive cough and generalized malaise for the last 2 weeks. So 3 weeks ago, he underwent surgery at your hospital. Physical examination reveals diminished breath sounds in the right mid-lung field. Chest X-ray shows an infiltrative shadow within cavity formation in the right mid-lung field. Assuming the etiology on this condition, what is the known most common cause? Which of the following is the most effective treatment for that? So the patient is 52 years old, presenting with productive cough, generalized malaise for the last 2 weeks, and 3 weeks ago he underwent surgery. Now physical examination will diminished breath sounds in the right mid lung field, and there is infiltrative shadow in the chest X-ray with thin cavity formation is there. So first of all, but the situation is, this is actually the lung abscess. So the patient presents with some non-specific respiratory symptoms, but the physical examination and the findings on the chest X-ray are suggestive of a lung abscess. So what is lung abscess? It is defined as necrosis of the pulmonary tissue and the formation of cavities containing necrotic debris or fluid caused by the microbial infection. It may be primary or secondary. A primary lung abscess occurs when one or two cavities with air-filled levels form in the lung parenchyma as a result of an aspiration of pathogen-laden secretion. So primary lung abscess is basically caused by aspiration of pathogen-laden secretions, and the secondary lung abscess develops from predisposing conditions such as congenital lung abnormalities, obstructing neoplasms, a foreign body, and bronchiectasis. So primary lung abscesses are more common than secondary lung abscesses, and aspiration accounts for 80 to 90% of primary lung abscesses, and particularly so in post-operative patients. Given this etiology, majority of the lung abscesses are caused by anaerobic bacteria Assuming this to be the etiology of the patient's condition, he should be treated with clindamycin. So here clindamycin is the best option. So it covers both anaerobic bacteria as well as methicillin resistant staphylococcus. So aspiration is the most common cause of lung abscess in post-operative patients. Since majority of the aspiration induced lung abscesses, the infectious agents are anaerobic bacteria. So the most effective treatment is clindamycin. Next question. 25-year-old white male who has a poorly controlled major seizure disorder and a 6-week history of recurrent fever, anorexia and persistent productive cough visiting to your office. So there is 6-week history of recurrent fever and now there is anorexia, persistent producing cough. So on physical examination, he is noted to have a temperature of 38.3 degrees (101 Fahrenheit), a respiratory rate of 16 per minute, gingival hyperplasia and a fetid odor to his breath. So there is also fetid odor in bronchic tests, but there here some features that are differentiating are anorexia, persistent productive cough with gingival hyperplasia sometimes and fetid odor to his breath. It is also, but in bronchic tests there is chronic cough with dyspnea with sometimes hemoptysis. There are local crackles, inspiratory and expiratory wheezes, and on CT we can be able to differentiate this. And in lung abscess we have mostly, we can see in chest x-ray the cavities are present and we can see the cavity in the lungs. So which one of the following is most likely to be found on a chest radiograph? So it is a lung abscess. So anaerobic lung abscesses are most often found in a person predisposed to aspiration who complains of a productive cough associated with fever, anorexia and weakness. Physical examination usually reveals poor dental hygiene, a fetid odor to the breath and sputum rails, and pulmonary findings are consistent with consolidations. So the other options here, patients who have sarcoidosis usually do not have a productive cough and have bilateral physical findings. And the persistent productive cough is not a striking finding in disseminated tuberculosis, which would be suggested by miliary calcifications on a chest film. And the clinical presentation and physical findings are not consistent with a simple mass in the right hilum nor with the right pleural effusion. So it is mostly the lung abscess in which there is patient have fever, anorexia, persistent productive cough and also have gingival hyperplasia and a fetid odor to his breath. So some points at the end from bronchic tests I want to just discuss over here is, in bronchic tests the treatment is, we can do vaccination, influenza and pneumococcal vaccination, chest physiotherapy, breathing exercise, physical exercise, antibiotics we can use, oral, IV, inhaled. In inhaled antibiotics, they are used chronically to decrease bacterial load driven by sputum bacteriology. And for example, inhaled tobramycin used chronically to suppress pseudomonas and reduce exacerbations, and oral routinely used for exacerbations driven by sputum sensitivity. Macrolides may be used chronically for an anti-inflammatory effect chronically. And the mucolytics are also used, for example, hypertonic, saline. Inhaled corticosteroids are also sometimes used to decrease the inflammation, but they may increase the risk of exacerbations. Oral corticosteroids for acute major exacerbations and pulmonary resection in selected cases with focal bronchiectasis. And there is transplant for the end stage diffuse causes, for example, primary ciliary dyskinesia. So